More now in today's jobs report with Shields and Brooks. That is Syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. You're together again, John. It's great to have you.
So you don't have difficulty.
You've ironed them out. So not the greatest jobs report, Mark. What does it mean for the presidential election?
Judy, there's no silver lining. There's not a tin lining. There's not a chrome lining. There's not even there's nothing that's good here for the president. The late Bob Teeter, who was George Herbert Walker Bush's campaign chairman and pollster, remarked after the 1992 campaign, which President Bush lost, that while the economy was improving, that it takes a full 3 months before that for people to get a sense of change and improvement in the economy. And this is getting closer. We're now into June, and these numbers, when people's attitudes are starting to solidify and how they feel about the economy. So I guess the only bright spot, if there is one, is, was made in Margaret's piece, where retail sales are up, car sales are up, gas prices are still down. But what was missing, it seemed to me today, from the administration and the president was any sense of this is what we want to do. I mean, shouldn't he call a Republican House, say we've got to pass the highway bill? It passed the Senate 74-22. We lost 28,000 construction jobs. This is something we ought to do right now instead of sort of a back and forth and it's Europe and it's too many problems.
And the White House is saying, David, the president's going to say in his Saturday address tomorrow, he's going to call on Congress to do something.
Yeah, I'm not sure how much. I mean, listen, we're borrowing $1 trillion a year. We're borrowing 40 cents on a dollar. Do we really think if we borrow $1.1 trillion a year, somehow that's going to magically transform the economy? I'm a little dubious. This is a structural problem. As people said, it's the fear factor. You've got, first of all, you had health care. What's my health care going to look like? Then you had the budget debacle, which was mostly the Republicans' fault last summer. Then you've got Europe, which is in a stage of, I think, slow collapse. Then you've got China and India growth slowing, and then you've got the fiscal cliff in December. So you've got just uncertainty piling on uncertainty, government introducing uncertainty even more than we've already got. And so the economy 6 months out really matters in elections, and there's not that much reason to think it's going to get suddenly better.
So is there time? I mean, maybe it's not the time yet to ask this question, but is there time for the president to turn it in his direction? I mean, is time running out for him?
Well, I mean, no, it's an even race. I mean, it really is. It's within the margin of error. But I think it's the kind of race that if the numbers continue to trend in this direction, and we all pray as Americans that they don't, because we don't want to see further suffering. The statistics don't bleed, but we know behind all these numbers there are human beings and families that are facing tragedy every day. Then it becomes a race about disqualifying, a campaign about disqualifying your opponent. And that's not an attractive or appealing. It's not hope and change. It's blood and guts.
Well, I would say it's also hard to do. Most elections are referenda, and they're referenda on the record. It's very hard for an incumbent to make a choice election. So the president is obviously going to try. He's going to have to. And to some extent, you have to feel sorry for him. This is, in large degree, not his fault. Things are happening way beyond his control. I don't believe a president has control over a quarterly economy in any case. But the European situation is certainly not his fault. The Chinese slowdown is not his fault. Mm-hmm. And the Europe thing cannot be underestimated. There was a study by some economists this week that say Greece leaves the euro peacefully. Well, that reduces our growth to 1.7. Say it brings Spain and Italy, it's much messier. Then it's even worse. Obama has really very little control, and he's sort of a victim of this myth that presidents control the economy quarter to quarter.
So, Mark, he may not be responsible for it all, but he's going to bear the brunt. And one thing he's been saying is he's been going to individual states, swing states, where the economy's doing a little bit better than for the country as a whole. Could that provide some salvage or?
Well, it's provided some encouragement and consolation, I think, for Democrats as the winds have turned north and hibernal on them. But I think, Judy, in the final analysis, people's assessment of the economy is national. I mean, it's the national unemployment rate. It's the Dow Jones average. It's how people feel about the country. Those are all national figures. You may feel better personally about your own situation if your state is doing better. I think it probably helps in a place like Ohio, because you can make the case there that the president's initiative and leadership on the auto bailout has made the difference and turned Ohio around. I think you can do that. But it hasn't right now. I mean, Iowa is a dead heat. And that's an unemployment rate of 5%.
As an ironist, you would like to think that he'll be saved by fracking, that the energy industry in some of these swing states will pull him out, even though he hasn't been the strongest champion. But you look at the polls, the swing states are not out of the ordinary. Yeah. You know, the huge growth in the oil sector, energy sector, isn't bringing him that much. And in places like Ohio, they're just dead even. Colorado, dead even. A lot of those states just dead even right now.
Meanwhile, a remarkable story in the New York Times, your paper this morning, David, about the White House being behind this massive effort to do a computer attack on Iran's nuclear program, so-called Stuxnet. Mm-hmm. Mark, what are we to make of this?
I think, Judy, there are several parts to it. I mean, first of all, it's a message that we're doing more to pursue our national security than simply putting boots on the ground and troops in places like Iraq and Afghanistan. I think it's also a message that to those who are urging military confrontation or invasion to Iran, that that we are have means of disabling and certainly hurting their capacity.
Almost
to
invisible means.
Almost invisible means. I think it's also at a political level an attempt, just as the drone story was earlier in the week, to show the president as a commander-in-chief, hands-on, personally engaged, personally involved, and to communicate strength.
Another New York Times story, your paper, talking about how closely the president is monitoring and making decisions on who gets hit.
Right, and this latest story was, this latest story was David Sanger, a forthcoming book, and a remarkable story. And I think President Bush pulled Obama aside before the inauguration, said we've got these two programs, the drones, the Stuxnet, they didn't call it that, they called it Olympic Games, but here's what you should do. And I think Obama has continued extremely aggressively. He's a kind of a ruthless guy, both politically and in foreign affairs, and he's done it, I think, pretty well. Now, there are some clear doubts about drones, and there are some legitimate doubts. Should a White House have the power to essentially assassinate people? And then we, as the government, most vulnerable to cyber terrorism because of how much we rely on computers, we are now on record as saying, yes, we have cyber terror. We're doing it to others. And so there's double-edged swords here. Nonetheless, I think the bottom line is, especially vis-a-vis Iran, is that these are pretty effective programs. If you think government can't do anything, the Iranians were wondering, what's going on? Why are these things spinning weirdly out of control? They were firing people. They thought there was something wrong in the machinery. We had people in our intelligence agencies doing something pretty impressive, I think.
Yeah, I would just say that there are a number of people who have grave moral reservations about the over-reliance on drones, that there's something nice about it because you don't see the
victims.
Almost
antiseptic.
It's antiseptic, and I don't get blood or gristle on my hands. I don't see people suffer. I think that was an attempt to show that the president is personally engaged, concerned about the collateral damage, that he's personally hasn't subcontracted this out or been indifferent or just sort of delegated. But at the same time, I think the question that's asked is, who would you least like to have as president right now, and do you want that person having these powers? I mean, I think the muted has been the criticism of the liberals and the Democrats on the left because it's Barack Obama. But if it were Newt Gingrich or somebody who they don't think as highly of or might think might be reckless,
making those kinds of decisions. Yeah. Two surrogates in the news, David, this week, former President Bill Clinton and Donald Trump. Trump out there talking up how he still doesn't believe the president was born in the United States. He's a surrogate for Mitt Romney. Bill Clinton saying that he doesn't agree with the Obama approach of criticizing Romney's record at Bain Capital.
Yeah, first on Trump, certainly a mixed blessing. Let's put it this way. But I do think there is a positive side to the blessing. The negative side is obvious. He's a bit of a buffoon. But the positive side is there are a lot of people, a lot of entrepreneurs, a lot of immigrants who go to Trump University, who buy Trump books, who like the idea of Trump Tower. He is a symbol for a lot of Americans of social mobility, of starting a business and making it. And so I do think he brings an audience, an important audience around. So it's not automatic that you'd want to write the guy off. For President Clinton, I don't think he should be out campaigning. because he's former president. He has independent thoughts. He's going to say what he thinks. And he thinks, which I think is true, that Romney has a sterling record. Well, that's not going to be the strict talking point of the campaign. I sort of like President Bush's strategy to stay out of the campaign. I think former presidents should make pronouncements, not try to be surrogates for candidates.
I disagree on both counts. Right. I mean, I think Donald Trump
is... That's why we have you.
Donald Trump's a disaster, an unmitigated disaster. The same national survey that asked favorable, unfavorable of the two men, Bill Clinton was 67-29 favorable. Donald Trump was 29-67 unfavorable. And that's the assessment of him. He talks about the Bertha thing, Judy, and one out of four, that is most I've ever seen, believe that the president was not born in the United States. These are people, this is an expressed belief. Nobody really believes it. It's because they loathe Barack Obama, they believe it. It's the same way that when somebody is against the science of global warming, so they don't like, because they don't like the remedies of global warming, so they reject it. That's what this is. He's not appealing to anybody. He's raising an issue that does Mitt Romney disservice. The problem is, this is a campaign where all holds are barred for money. And you'll go anywhere to get money. Donald Trump in Las Vegas, Sheldon Adelson, $2 million. That's the price he paid, was it a right. day of stories about Bertha.
So you're saying he does have a following, and it's all about the, a lot of it is about money.
It's about money, and I just think Bill Clinton is the most successful advocate. The Democrats do not have surrogates. The Obama administration has not developed a team of surrogates. I think Bill Clinton is the most, the most effective. There's no Chris Christie right now on the Democratic side.
Finally, just less than a minute, John Edwards' verdict, not guilty on one count and hung jury on the rest of it.
Yeah, I was glad he got acquitted. Not that I think he's a sterling model of character, but there are things you should not be prosecuted for. And I think what he did was wrong, but not prosecuted for. And so I thought it was fine.
It was all a campaign finance violation, whether he didn't tell the truth about spending campaign money for his mistress.
Yeah, and Rich Lowry, who's a colleague of ours on the show from time to time, made the point that John Edwards ought not to be in jail. He ought to be under a rock. And I mean, that's the sentence. The sentence is that wherever he goes, it's the first line of his obituary, unless he takes the talents, which are enormous, and really does something with it. And, outside of politics and public service, I mean, I think he's capable of it. He's a person of great charisma and great talent. And I'll be interested to see what he does with the rest of his life.
We will leave it there. Mark Shields, David Brooks, thank you both. And you can see still more with Mark and David on the doubleheader. That's on our website, coming up right after this program.